Okay, so welcome to Yoga with Smiles. We have Smile Makers Trainings giving you smile tips on Tuesday, and we have Brindavan Yoga. Dr. Sharda is here giving yoga exercises on Fridays. And it's a pleasure to meet you week after week. So, you know, in India today we are celebrating the festival of Dasara, which is going to come very soon. And I thought this would be a very good opportunity to talk about female energy, you know. So I have this in front of me, okay. This is one of the first things which I bought many years back, okay. Does this make sense to you? What is this? Yeah? What is it? What does it look like?
It's an iPad,
okay?
Okay.
An iPad by itself does not make any sense, okay?
Yeah, I also don't need it.
Yeah, so no, but by itself, if I just keep this in front of you, I don't think it is worth anything. What do you think is going to make this worthwhile? Yeah? Think about it. There is, if you want this to really be useful to you, what is required? Common sense? Yeah?
You have to charge it.
You have to charge it, correct. You need, it needs the energy. You require something behind the scenes, okay? Something like a cord. Yeah, you need a cord. And you need to connect this to some electrical energy. And then that same iPad will be visible and it will be useful to everybody. Okay? So,
yeah.
There is two kinds of energies. One which is visible in the front and one which is not visible. It is behind the scenes. Now, both are equally important. And unless... So, we all know that electricity is important. But we cannot, neither you can see it, neither I can see it. But we know that this electrical energy is present, which is helpful to make the device work, isn't it? So what has that got to do with female energy? You know, this is what female energy is about. Okay? Most of the time, we cannot actually see the female energy. We cannot see the power of the female energy. The female energy is the one that gives power to everything. You know, we always associate with something external. So there is masculine energy, which is associated with something external. You know, you can actually see it's about doing, it's about leading, it's about giving, and it's about, you know, all that is masculine energy. But behind this, there is another energy, which is a female energy, which is more about being. It's more on the, you know, emotional side. It's more about receiving. It's more about creating. Okay? And our human nature is such, you know, in the Chinese, and you know, this female energy has been worshipped by all civilizations. So when I went to Egypt, I saw temples dedicated to the female goddess. In India, we have temples dedicated to the female goddess. In Christianity, we have Mother Mary, who we all pray to, you know. So we know that there is a huge power in this female energy. You know, when I was staying in Bombay, there used to be a statue next to my house of Mother Mary with a child, carrying a child. And I remember every day I used to pray, whenever I used to go, my car park was next to that. And every day I used to pray and I would say, God, take care of my son. You know, he's gone abroad in Australia. Please take care of him. You know, one small prayer I would give whenever I was passing by. You know, because there is something about all of us. We have all born out of the female energy. You know, and we are also mothers. And we know what it is. I think you are the strongest power that a child can ever have. Okay? So, when a child prays to the mother, you know, there is absolute unconditional love that the mother gives to the child. You know that because you will do that. You will move heaven and earth and you will do whatever it takes to ensure that your child is, you know, taken care, well taken care of. So the point which I'm trying to make is that when we pray to the mother, that is such a wonderful relationship. It is such a wonderful, powerful relationship because we know that the mother has got some unbelievable bond and a mother will take care of us come what may. Okay? Now, this female energy which is there in a body, you think it's only females have this female energy? Or do you think only males have a masculine energy and do you think only females have a female energy? What do you think?
No.
No.
It needs both sides.
Yes. You know, one of the things which
the
I...
The yin and the yang.
Yeah, the yin and the yang. So the Chinese recognize it as yin and the yang. Okay? So I want you to now become aware of what is the energy that you are displaying most of the time. So I will give you my personal experience. So when I was in college, in school actually, when I finished 10th standard, I remember that those days we didn't have much brains of our own, you know, we just did whatever our parents told us, you know, and now I wonder, like, how come it was like that? And I remember I finished my 10th standard and I came and I told my father, you know, I got fourth highest in the school and I got 144 out of 150 in maths and, you know, 139, I think, out of 150 in science. And I said, what do you want to do? He said, I told him I want to become, do science and become an engineer. And he said, mad or what? What girl engineer? He says, you know. And, you know, the idea of girls as engineers in 1978, I really don't know. And he said, no, you got such high eye power, I'm blind without my specs. So he says, oh my God, he says, you'll spoil your eyes, no need. You're a girl, you do BCom. I hated my BCom, honestly. I don't know why I did it. Okay? But that one sentence, you're a girl, no need for you to study too much. You know, somewhere down the line, that 14, 15-year-old girl decided that, oh my God, I'm a girl. Because I'm a girl, there are certain things I can do, there are certain things I cannot do. And somewhere down the line, I just hated the idea of being a girl. You know? And I was thinking, boys are so lucky. They can just get married and they can just get a partner and continue with this whole life. And look at us. We have to give up our house, give up our circle, give up our friends, give up everything and go and start a new life all over again with some stranger. What is that? What is this? And trust me, any work that involves going out of the house, you know, it being the ration office or the garage or the bank or anything, I would be happily ready to do that. And any work which is associated with the feminine energy, you know, I would not even wash one spoon if my maid doesn't come. Because somehow I associated that with female energy. And most of us... Who's talking? I am disturbed. Yeah. So we don't realize it. And for a long time in life, I was most of the time happy to use my masculine energy. Okay? So, and the soft feminine side of me, somewhere that got hidden in the corner. So my invitation to you today is just check, okay? So there's a hard side of you, there's a soft side of you. There is a logical side of you, there's an emotion side of you. We have the right side and we have the left side. You know, the right brain and the left brain, you know, both of us, we take care of different things. And if you look around today, look at all these youngsters there, okay? Look at the amount of people who are having problems with their monthly cycles, who are having PCODs, who are having PMS and all these gynecological problems. I'm seeing youngsters who are having their uterus removed operations. You know, there is so much of feminine related physical issues that people are going through. And do you wonder why? Why do you think there's so much of physical problems related to gynecology now? It's quite common, because when I grew up, I did not know what was the meaning of PCOD, or, you know, I had not even heard those terms. Yeah, you know, quietly we would have our periods, and quietly, and we don't even talk about our periods. It was such a taboo thing to talk about, you know, and now we are finding so many issues. So there has been research that has been done on this, and whatever I quote, you know, because I've read somewhere and somebody has done something. And what they say is that most of the women now are not enjoying their feminine side. Most of the women now are resisting the feminine process. You know, instead of enjoying your periods and saying, yes, I'm so glad that I'm still getting my periods, instead of honoring that, and instead of, you know, being grateful for being a woman, you know, people are resisting that. I'm not saying all, but I'm just saying the trend now. Okay? So, and when you resist your femininity, that shows up in your, I told you, all your physical issues are related to some kind of mental thinking. And it shows up in your physical issues. Every month people have problems during the periods and all that. So I think this continued for some time, and one day I went and I attended something called a Shakti workshop. Okay, so Shakti workshop is, Shakti is the feminine energy, and Shiva is, you know, in Hindu maybe Shiva is what we consider as the male energy, and Shiva and Shakti are the combination which actually gets things done. If you look at a Shiva linga, you know, if you go to a Hindu temple and you look at the linga of the Shiva, the linga is inside a yoni, that is the female and the male reproductive system is shown together, you know, and that is the beginning of creation. But we don't talk about it. We think that it is something which cannot be discussed. So I went to this Shakti workshop, and this was a workshop which honors the female energy. And I suddenly got present to how much of masculine energy I'm using all the time. So I had my husband's three friends who had come over from another country staying with us. And all the time I was like, you know, let's do this, let's do that, let's go there, you know. And I was thinking, why am I trying to, you know, lead everywhere? And I decided, for the first time in my life, I decided just to let go. And I decided, you know, why don't you just get pampered, and why don't you enjoy being pampered? So I'm asking you a question, you know, when you go outside, do you like if somebody opens the door for you? You know, you say chivalry is dead, or chivalry is sleeping, but sometimes it's nice. It's nice to be pampered, isn't it? So my request to you is, do what you can to nourish the feminine side of you. Go for your massage. Go for your beauty parlor. You know, try out some new clothes. I mean, I'm just wearing this today. I'm wearing this just because, you know, I felt like wearing something feminine. You know, and there is a lot of power in the feminine energy. So my life is replete with examples of how feminine energy has, praying to the feminine energy has created miracles in my life. You know, so there was a, when my daughter was young, you know, she was quite tough, okay, she would just go to the garden, and 2-year-old girl would just pull down somebody from the swing and sit on the swing. And one of my neighbors said, oh, I look at her and she reminds me of Kali. Kali, you know, Kali is a goddess which who takes care, who destroys the evil and safeguards you against danger. Okay, so I had taken her when he was 2.5 years old. I had taken her to this Calcutta Dakshineshwara temple, which is a Kali temple. And 25 years later, when we were coming from Bhutan, okay, we hardly had 1 hour, one and a half hour transit of Calcutta. And in that time, I ensured, like, we changed rickshaws and I don't know how many, we walked through all the crowds and this and that. And we went to the temple again because I said, because, you know, I have appointed Kali God as her personal goddess who's going to take care of my daughter when she goes around the world. And I don't know how we did it. It was most difficult, but somehow after 25 years, we went to the temple again. And you won't believe, within, I think probably on the same day, she got a call for a new job in Netherlands where she wanted to go. She was in Canada at that time. She wanted to go to Netherlands. And what are the odds that email comes at the time that we were in the temple? So think about it. Okay, think about the number of times where, you know, you ask for something with your heart and the God can give, Goddess gives it to you. So there is, so I will just, I think it's getting dark. Can you see me? I'll just put on the light and come 1 second now. Okay, so, you know, I thought now because we are coming, because the festival of Dasara is coming up, you know, whether you are Hindu or not a Hindu, you know, I just want to talk about certain aspects of the feminine energy, which is applicable to all, okay? So, on the 9 days of Dasara, what we do is that we honor the 9 goddesses. And these are different forms of the goddess. We don't know whether God came first or goddesses came first. Okay, we don't know who's better. This discussion is not about that. Whether the masculine is better or the feminine. The discussion is that both complement each other. So there was a huge 100-year-old war that was going on between the gods and the demons. Okay, and the gods were losing. And finally, when they came together and they all decided to give all their energies. Different gods gave different energies. And when they gave their energies to, and they created a goddess. And this goddess, I don't know whether you can see it. This was a goddess called Durga. Okay? She has got 18 gifts of... Can you see this? Okay? And she's the one, she had this fight with the demons for 9 days, and on the 10th day she emerged victorious. Okay, so that is the reason why we are celebrating this festival here, because this is one period where the whole country is working towards honoring the female energy, and they, all of them are praying to the female god. And you need to understand that for the 9 days we have 9 different goddesses, and each goddess represents one quality. Okay? So I'm just going through these qualities. When I talk about the goddess, okay, don't look at it as a Hindu or a Catholic or a, you know, religious thing. I just want you to concentrate on the qualities. Okay? Because every goddess is depicting one quality. You need to ask yourself, do you have that quality in you? Okay? And we being women, we are a powerhouse. We are a powerhouse of strengths and abilities, huge abilities we have, okay? And we need to 1 second, I got to call one, just decline that, huh? So we need to admire this quality. So the day one, she's called Shailaputri, that is the daughter of the mountains, okay? So she's the one who's got immense determination. So one of the first qualities you need to have is be absolutely determined, be absolutely focused on what is it that you want. Okay, she is the one who wanted to marry Shiva, so she had intense determination. Okay, the second one is called Brahmacharini. She is the one who has been created by Lord Brahma, and what she has is a lot amount of meditative knowledge. So as women, think, okay, we have a lot of meditative knowledge. We have that powerhouse of knowledge within us. Okay, the third one is called Chandra Ganta. Okay, Chandra is the moon. So we have the peaceful bliss like the moon, like the cool. So we know how to be cool also, isn't it? So we have the peaceful bliss of the moon, and we have that control over our emotions. Okay. The next one is called Kushmanda. Okay. Now this is Ku, Ushma, Anda. If you look at that way, it means little universe creation. It's so beautiful. Okay. What she signifies is that we are the creators of the universe, of the cosmos. And the whole cosmos is within us. This sounds like a very big concept, but once you get that, it will change your life. Whatever is happening around your environment is actually happening inside you. Whatever is happening inside you is reflected inside your environment. Think about it. There, that cosmic energy is your physical energy. There is no difference between the cosmic energy and you. You know? And this goddess represents that. Okay? Then we have Skanda Mata. Skanda Mata is mother of Skanda, mother of Kartik god. And she represents immense knowledge. If you know, we are so intelligent, we have so much of wisdom within us. All these qualities are there within us. We are multifaceted. And this is, if you pray to her, this intelligence what you have, even an ignorant idiot will turn out. Kalidas was not, but just an ordinary man. And he prayed to this god, and he produced so much wonderful works of literature. So she is called Skanda Mata. Okay. Then you have Katyayani. Okay, she's also a person who, but she's actually a warrior goddess. Okay, she's the one who will fight. This is the fierce form of goddess. So in when we are provoked, we also have that warrior within us, and we are able to fight and fight to remove all the negativity, whatever is there around us. And she's the one who fights to uphold the goodness, to uphold dharma. Okay, then I told you about Kali, Kal Ratri. Kal Ratri means the one who is the enemy of darkness. Okay, this is another warrior, another fierce form of the goddess. Here she also fights, but she fights so that she annihilates the dangers that have come to you. She fights to keep you safe. Okay, so you think whether you do that. Are you the person who is ready to fight against whatever happens? If there is anything negative and you want to protect your people, I think you have the ability to fight. Okay? And then we have Mahagauri. Okay? She is the great goddess. She comes on a bull. Okay? And just like you have this wish-fulfilling cow who fulfills all your desires. Okay? You have the ability to fulfill the desires of the people around you. So sometimes you're a Mahagauri, sometimes you're a Kali, sometimes you're, okay. Then we have the now ninth version is called Siddhi Dantri, okay. Siddhi Dantri. Siddhi means capability, okay. When you have extraordinary capability, you have Ashta Siddhi, there are eight kinds of capabilities. And when you have the ability and you have the perfection of that ability, okay, and you have a mastery over your skills, okay, she is the one who grants you that. Okay, so I thought this would be quite interesting to, because it is a Dasara and because we are into this festival season that is coming up. I thought, when you go through this next festive season, keep saying thank you for the feminine energy that you have. Okay? So there are different, and I would like to also tell you, I hope it was interesting. Okay? So when you talk about the Dasara, the 10th day, 10th day is you use all your powers and you use all your skills and you use your intelligence, your wisdom, your meditative spirit, your knowledge, your warrior qualities, every single qualities, all the different qualities. Okay? We are using it in our daily life, isn't it? Okay? Sometimes when you look at yourself in the mirror, okay, there is no difference between goddess and you. You are a goddess. Okay? And the goddess in you manifests in different ways. And when you get this, okay, your life becomes so much powerful. You can be a combination of bliss, you can be a combination of being a warrior. You can be a combination of all the different skills that these nine goddesses of Dasara stand for. Okay? So I don't know whether you know, but there is also another, if anybody of you all have traveled to Himachal Pradesh. So Himachal is called Deva Bhumi. It is called Land of the Devis. Okay? So, and it's, your churches or your temples and most of these ancient places which of worship, they are usually built on a spot which is considered to be extremely high in spiritual energy. And automatically, when you go to a church or when you go to a temple, you automatically imbibe that high spiritual energy of that place, isn't it? I want to talk about my experiences of going to Himachal. I just love going to Himachal, and whenever I get a chance, I spend a lot of time there. Okay? So there is a mythological story that the first, in one of the lives of Shiva, his wife was called Sati, and due to whatever reason, okay, she had to die, and Shiva was so upset. So upset that he carried her body in his hand, and he did the cosmic dance of destruction. He was so upset. He said, "I will keep dancing this dance of destruction till this body decays in my hand." And he did his angry thunder dance of destruction, and all the goddesses were very worried, and they did not know what to do and how to stop him. Okay, see, attachment is not good. There is a difference being committed to your children or to your spouse, and the difference being attached to your spouse. So Lord Vishnu decided that he has to stop this attachment and stop him from the attachment to the dead body. So Lord Vishnu, through his discuss, and one by one, the parts of the dead body of his wife Sati started falling onto the earth. Okay, and it kept on falling part by part. So 51 parts of the body fell down at 51 different places on this earth. Now this is a story that has been handed on over the ages, but it's quite interesting, And suddenly one day he realized he has not no body left in his hand. Okay, so that's how the world got saved, because otherwise the world would have been destroyed by the time this body would have decayed. These 51 parts which fell in different places of the earth have got temples in that spot. Okay, so when you go to the temple, you can feel the power of the divine energy over there. So I was doing a training in Himachal, and I finished the training by around 6 o'clock in the evening, and I wanted to go to this nearby, not nearby, but about 2 hours drive to one of the spots where her tongue is supposed to have fallen down. That is called Jwalaji. Okay? And the beauty of the, and I did go there. I left at 6 o'clock. I reached around 8, 8:30 in the night, alone with my company driver. And the beauty of that place is that there are 9 spots where fire comes out from the rocks. Until today, the ONGC, the gas commission, all the scientific people, they have tried to find out the source of the fire, and they still cannot find what's the source of the fire. You know? So, and the fire, the flames that come out from the rocks, they look like tongues. So when you go over there, you know, it is so nice. You just honor the tongue and you honor my God. I hope I use my tongue to create value for people instead of the other way around. And the energy of the place was amazing. I came back at 12:30. The whole office was so worried about me. But I said, Goddess is with me. You know, I want to see the place. She called me and that's why I went. Okay, I give another example of another place in Guwahati. We had all gone together to Arunachal Pradesh. I think Kusum was there, I think. But I decided at 4:30 in the morning, I want to see that place. Okay, and in Guwahati, there is a temple where the vagina of the goddess is supposed to have fallen down. And people actually sit and honor the vagina. And I saw one idol on the wall over there, and it was depicted in the shape of a woman who was sitting like this. You know, she was sitting. Just show you how she was sitting. She was sitting with her legs spread like this, open. And it was so amazing because I had never ever seen a goddess sitting with her legs open. You know, and when you actually go down and when you go to the temple and you go, you're not worshipping an idol. There is a depression in the stone, which is actually the shape of a vagina, and there is water, which is 24 hours, 365 days, is water in it. And so basically you're actually honoring and you're praying to the source of your creation. I thought that was so beautiful. Isn't it? How many of us actually honor the source of our creation? Okay? So, and when I go to the temple, there is some unbelievable energy about that place. So these are, I just gave an example of 2 or 3 small temples. Okay? These are the temples where the parts of the body, I suppose, like I have gone to about 9 temples all across the country. And every time I go to a different temple, what is required over here is the faith that you have. What is required is, you know, without faith, you will not have any experience. But when you go with absolute faith and you say, Mother Goddess, please take care of all of us. And you also take care of everybody by, you know, imbibing the Mother Goddess in you. Okay? So, whether you call her Mother Mary or whether you call... I've had amazing experiences with Mother Mary also. Okay? I can just keep on thinking that every time I look at a photo and I feel that she's talking to me. I told you about the statue which was there next to my house in Bombay. Okay? When my nephew was born, I got a dream of Mother Mary coming, and my nephew was born during the Bandra Fair time, September 11th, and he had a lot of complications. And I remember I went to Mother Mary and I said, God, take care of him. So it doesn't matter what form, what religion. What matters is that, do you believe in the power of the female energy? Okay? So my only request at the end of this session is, you know, honor the female energy within you. Do things that pamper your female energy and try to be balanced between both your male and your female energy. Sometimes you require male, sometimes you require female. But I think what is required right now, we require our female energy to be nourished and to be cherished. Enjoy being a woman, you know, take advantage of being a woman and enjoy the beauty, the attraction, the softness, the whatever you call it, okay? Cherish that, love that, and honor the feminine energy within you. Okay? Make sense what I'm saying? Yeah? Small, simple message. Just be aware. And I want you to enjoy the next 10 days of Dasara that is coming up. And when the whole world is celebrating the goddess energy, you will celebrate the goddess energy within yourself. Everything is within you. Okay? So thank you very much. You've been a wonderful audience. And I look forward to seeing you next week. Okay?